everybody. Merry Christmas. Happy Hanukkah. Happy Kwanzaa. If you don't celebrate, happy Friday. And welcome to our second extravaganza where we have a multi-chef broadcast. I have assembled seven of the best whole food plant-based chefs that are going to do a complete Christmas dinner, SOS free, in about 90 minutes. We did this on Thanksgiving. We had hundreds of people cooking along. You sent us your photos. We're so glad that you're watching. We know that not everybody has loved ones to be with because of the pandemic. So we're your loved ones. We love you. And we're so happy you're here. So the first chef is my brother from another mother. I like to think that I gave him his start in this business because I've produced 19 conferences. And the first one called Healthy Taste of LA, he was actually going to be a guest. And then a chef canceled. And then he got a spot. And then I never really had to invite him because every year there was always somebody that canceled. And I think he's probably presented in more in my conferences than any other chef. We used to have so much fun. For 8 years, we would do the holiday extravaganza at True North and we would do Iron Chefs together. And I sure miss that. But he is here today. He also participated from work in the Thanksgiving one. Go check out that episode because he made an incredible soup that was a yin-yang, beautiful soup. The recipes are on YouTube. But today he finally has a day off and he's going to kick off our extravaganza with a spicy holiday punch freeze. Welcome, Chef Ramses. Bravo. Thanks for doing this on your one day off in like the whole year.
Hi, AJ. Hello, everybody. Happy to be here. Merry Christmas to everybody. Merry Christmas, AJ and Charles and Bailey and everybody out there. And if you're not a Christmas person, more of a Hanukkah or Kwanzaa or whatever, happy holidays to everybody. So here I am. I'm going to adjust my camera now to focus on the pot here on the stove, which I think you can see now. Beautiful. Okay, so this is I can't remember who or what I wrote this recipe for. This is a spicy apple cider that I like to do around holidays, Thanksgiving, Christmas, even New Year. Growing up, we always had some sort of punch, fruit punch for the holidays. And so you guys have the recipe. The recipe calls for larger amounts because I'm figuring you're doing this for a gathering of like 6 to 8 people. So therefore you would want larger quantities. I'm gonna do a smaller quantity version so that we can see what's happening in the pot as I go along. So in goes my unfiltered, preferably apple juice. So I'm doing about a quarter-ish of the recipe. So this calls for a gallon of apple juice. I'm doing about a quart. It calls for 2 cups of pineapple juice. So I'm gonna do about a half-ish cup. All right. So in goes my cinnamon stick, my mulling spices. And then I have here my serrano chili, which is split in half, which that goes in. All right. Now I have here an orange. This guy came from my aunt's tree here in town. So she gave me a whole bag for Christmas and I was very grateful about it. So I'm taking my peeler and just doing long strips for this. And then I cut it in half and then I squeeze the juice into the pot. There we go. All right. And then also I have a lemon here. Now I do this sometimes with, with the peeler again, or if you want, you could also use a microplane zester, which is a wonderful tool to have because as you do this, the only thing that gets grated into your pot, your pan, your bowl, whatever it is, it's just the rind. None of the white membrane goes in. So that can go in. And I'm also gonna squeeze my lemon in, and I'm going to try to catch the pits here. It won't hurt the flavor at all, but if it goes into somebody's cup and they might chew on it. There we go. A couple of these made their way in there, but now we got them out. Excellent. Now I'm going to take my the recipe I gave you called for Granny Smith apples. I have here a similar variety, which is a Pink Lady. And I say similar because of the flavor profile. So Granny Smith apples are very sour type apples. They're the sort of preferred baking apple for pastry chefs. The reason for that is they are more on the acidic side than the sweet side. So once the sugar gets added or whatever, or the dates or whatnot to the dessert, they hold up better. And so it's a fairly simple recipe. You just get everything in the pot and then you allow it to cook and simmer for a while. So all the flavors sort of blend into one another. But I wanted to give you a little bit more of the thought process here. So I have my base here being the apple juice. And of course, you know that I'm a SOS-free chef, so I don't use any sugar in my cooking. So that is my sugar, essentially, the apple juice. Once that's in there, I want this to be very enjoyable for people, and I don't want it to be too sweet. I don't want it to be overwhelming. I want somebody to have a full mug of this holiday punch and enjoy it from start to finish. So what that means is I have to give it balance. That's why a little bit of the pineapple juice goes in, then the orange and the lemon. So I'm trying to give it some acidity, some tartness to go along with the sweetness so that it gives it balance. Otherwise, it's just too sweet. If all I end up using is straight up apple juice with all the other stuff, it's too sweet. So I'm trying to give it enough contrast. Along those lines, that's the reason why I use the Serrano chili in here, because I always like spicy with sweets. They go together very well. So again, that's more of a balance, contrast of flavor, so that as you have that mug of cider, you're really enjoying it because you're like, oh man, there's all this sort of flavors that, you know, bounce off of one another, and there's complexity here. And then after that, then we go into the depth of flavor by adding the cinnamon stick and then the mulling spices. So that sort of creates a deeper, longer finish. And as you take a sip to this every single time, there's a good amount of depth of flavor. Plus, there's also that contrast between the sweet, the tartness, which provides this hint of sour in there, and the spiciness of this. So this guy here is about to come to a boil. And what you want to watch out for is you don't want this to be at a rapid boil, because then it starts spilling all over the place. And because it's fruit juices, whatever they land on, everything becomes very sticky. It's not like just plain water that's sort of boiling over and then you just wipe it down and you're done. With the natural sugar content in there, everything gets sort of sticky. So now that it's come to a boil, I'm going to take it down to a gentle simmer. And now I just...
Hey, Ramses, I got a question from Fabian. Hi, Fabian, how are you? Why use a hot plate on top of a stove? Why not just use the stove? And guys, the recipes are on YouTube. Just check the show notes.
I have an electric stove here at home, which I really don't like. electric stoves are not responsive. You know, they don't come on or turn off immediately as I want them to. So I always use, I have two of these, one, the other one's stored, but I always like to have a couple of these on my stove. And I basically use my stove as counter space. I live here on my own, except when my daughter is here on my days that I have her. So a couple burners is really all we need. And these guys, the induction burners, are so responsive. They heat everything up so quickly. As you see, this is now at a nice boil. I have to turn it down a little bit more, but they just heat up so quickly. And if I turn it off, it just turns off immediately versus a electric stove that sort of slowly comes up. And then when you turn it off, it's so slow to to turn off. So I always love these much better. So now that I've told you about that, one of the very important things about this is that a cider is really kind of like a soup. If you don't know this, soups and stews, or, you know, a cider here, they always taste much better a day later. So for whatever reason, all the flavors just sort of fully emerge into one another. Everything just comes together. All of the complexities come, you know, together. And then, 24 hours later, a soup will always taste better than if you eat it right as you made it. And same for a cider. And so I want to show you here. I'm going to switch pots. I made another one, and I can turn this off because this cooked already. So I want to give you a few variations just in case you don't have all the stuff. I make a cider-ish type of thing often, especially during wintertime for my staff. And in there, things like ginger will go in there. And this one doesn't have any mulling spices, but it does have allspice berries, which I love to use on a cider. There's also, hang on a second, I put a few of them in here. I have to find them. I put a few raspberries in here that might have disintegrated. Yeah, I think they fell apart. So you can't see them, but I actually put some raspberries in here. I have used blackberries in here as well. If you don't happen to have any lemons or oranges in your kitchen, you can add a touch of vinegar, you know, just a small splash, and that will give you that contrast of flavor, that little bit of tartness to go along with the sweetness of the fruit juice. So it's really like, you know, play around with it. You know, if you don't have apples, maybe you have pears, or maybe you're doing this during stone fruit season, and maybe you have some peaches or nectarines or even cherries. So you can get this nice sort of burgundy color to a cider. So it's really just a, you know, play around with it. I've sometimes have used vanilla extract or vanilla bean, and I'll throw that right in there. And again, it's once it simmers for a while and it sits, you know, especially if you have the patience to give it a 24-hour resting period, it comes out so, so delicious. And then if you just give it a quick taste to gauge how much of that spiciness went in there. So this Serrano definitely has spice. It's not spicy, it just gives it a little kick. It's sort of a tingle, a tease of your taste buds. And you're like, oh, that's spicy. Oh, well, no, it's actually kind of sweet and tart. And maybe there's a little bit of spice back in there. So all the flavors just sort of bounce around in your taste buds as you drink this. And it becomes just a really wonderful, just a wonderful drink to have, you know, especially for the holidays.
That is so cool. Now, does it have a Spanish name? Because that's what it, like, what did you call it on the recipe you sent me?
Well, the first recipe I sent you was called Ponche, which is translated really punch to ponche, which is a very traditional Mexican Christmas version of this. But for that, other things like I have here a little bit because I took a pot of it to my mom's house. I have here some hibiscus flowers, some dried hibiscus flowers. So that goes in that one. And then the tartness, believe it or not, comes from tamarind. So if you're familiar with this, so this is a tamarind pod. Sometimes you'll find, you know, tamarind paste or tamarind puree. But this is what an actual tamarind pod looks like. If I crack it, I can expose the fruit, which is has this very tart, but sort of very flavorful consistency. It actually makes the punch a little bit thicker. Then there's also, what else we put in? We put in guavas. We put in there sugar canes, like chunks of actual sugar cane in there. Traditionally, that's made with what's called piloncillo, which is a like a cone of solid brown sugar, which I don't use. Normally gets made with water plus a whole bunch of that sugar cone, but I just use apple juice, and then it totally takes away the need for any sugar at all.
That's great. Do you have to cook Christmas dinner, or do you get to enjoy not cooking on your one day off?
My mom actually cooked, so my contribution to the dinner was the big pots of those fruit punch to bring over, which is again very traditional. And that was it. She took the rest on, except my brother-in-law. He's not a cook, he's not a chef at all, but he likes baking during the holidays, so he made a pumpkin pie. That was his contribution to that.
Well, thank you for your contribution to healthy food all year long at True North and on your YouTube channel and on your courses. And we're going to post a link to Ramses's new course. His first one was amazing. The second one is as amazing, even maybe more amazing. So make sure you follow Ramses on his mailing list, on YouTube, on Facebook, because we want SOS Free to be the way to be.
All right. Yeah. So the link I sent you is a special link for everybody here. It's got the code Santa AJ, which is, if you click on it, it's already embedded. You don't have to do any extra in there. It's already calculated in there. So if you buy the advanced course with that link that I gave you, you'll get the pre-sale price, which was the, you know, lowest introductory price for the course. And then it went to full price. But now for everyone here today, you can get that introductory price.
And it would make a great Christmas gift. And as soon as I welcome our next chef and she gets started, then I will be fooling around in the chat and make sure that it gets posted.
Okay.
All right. Well, Merry Christmas. Feliz Navidad, Ramses. Thank you so much.
Thank you for having me.
We love having you. Take care. And Goodbye, everybody. Thank you so much. And so now we've had our beverage appetizer. Now we're going to have our real appetizer. And by the way, this is not long hair. These are goofy ears. This is from Disneyland. But yes, it does look like I have long hair. So I can go like this. So our next SOS Free chef also spent a lot of time doing wonderful culinary demos at both True North and the McDougal program. And she has a wonderful YouTube channel. She does weekly videos. She does a show called, I can't think of the name, Delicious Living, I think it is. And I can see that she's also wearing a hat. If you'd like to unmute yourself, I can introduce you now. She is going to be doing a potato bruschetta. And remember, all the recipes are already in YouTube. Some of them are typed out and some are links because YouTube only allows me 5,000 words. And that's why. If you want to see the whole show, if you came in a little bit late, you'll have to wait till it ends and then you can watch the whole thing in its entirety. But please, if you're not cooking with us, share this broadcast with other people. Hey, Thomas Allen. Hopefully somebody's going to be using vinegar today. Please welcome the adorable Katie May. Hi, Katie. Thank you so much for being here on Christmas. Day.
Merry Christmas. Thank you so much for having me on.
You look adorable in that hat.
Thank you. Likewise, goofy ears there. So today we're making, like you said, an appetizer, bruschetta potatoes. And I know our community is huge fans of potatoes instead of bread and other flour-based products. So potatoes are so versatile, and crostinis are similar to, if you haven't made crostinis yet with potatoes, you're gonna love it, and it's so easy to do. You're probably already cooking your potatoes in this way, whether you're making French fries or just roasted potatoes. They're so easy to do. So that's what I'm gonna do first. And if you're not familiar with the term crostini at all, what it means is typically it's bread, toasted baguettes sliced on the diagonal. So I have a Yukon Gold potato here. These work best for the size to get us the shape we're looking for. So baguettes, when they're sliced on the diagonal, they're about 3 inches long, maybe 1 inch by 3 inches or so. And of course, this doesn't need to be perfect. You can vary. But because we do want to put some topping on here, you want to go for like a Yukon Gold potato rather than just a tiny little baby potato. But those baby potatoes, red potatoes, they'll all work, okay? So what I'm doing here is just slicing the potato in about 1/4 inch to 1/2 inch slices. I actually try to go a little bit larger than 1/4 inch, because if you get them too small, they'll get kind of flimsy. And like your baguettes, you want them a little bit sturdy so that you can put a topping on it and actually pick it up with your hands. Okay, so I've got these about 1/2 inch, maybe even 1/3 inch wide, and you can put them right onto your baking sheet and go into the oven as if you were baking your French fries, oil-free French fries. You're gonna do this for, I do 425 for about 10 minutes and then flip them and do another 8 minutes or so. You wanna pay attention. And of course, if you wanna do this a little lower temperature, 400, you'll just go for a little longer. And if you have a convection setting on your oven, that's gonna be best. So you just layer them on here. But today, I already have some baked for you, but rather than putting this batch in the oven, what I wanna do is actually put some into my air fryer. So I have the Milky air fryer here. There's lots of different air fryers out there. The Breville Smart Oven Air is fantastic. But the Milky is a lid that goes right on top of the Instant Pot, right? I think Chef AJ has a few different types of the air fryers. I don't know that you have the Milky, but it's, I think I might've heard about it from you first. So it is fantastic. Because it's so easy to move around. I can take it, I'm actually going to be taking it to my family's house today to make a dish there. So we're gonna use this just like we would the oven. You put your potatoes in here, but in the air, this little guy, we only need to put it in for about, on the first round, I'm gonna do 10 minutes and then I'm gonna flip them and do another 5 minutes or so. So you just wanna pay attention to your potatoes. So we'll put these in here. Right on top, and there's a wrap that comes with the Milky, a wrap like this, and then the wrap here, they sit in the bottom. Put this on top. And you can only do so much at a time in this one. That's why the Breville Smart Oven Air is much nicer, much wider. So set our timer here. We'll go. Okay. So now that our potatoes are cooking, I have my tomatoes diced up. I'm going to add my tomatoes here. These are little cherry tomatoes, quartered. And we're going to add in our seasonings. So I have some garlic. And my spices, red pepper flakes, black pepper, and oregano. Oh, and I'm actually, there's one thing I'm missing. A little onion. So any onion will work. I have a yellow onion here. Just gonna slice about 1/4 of this. We don't want too much onion. And I'm chopping all of this by hand, but if you want to, you can put these, the garlic, the onion, the tomatoes right into a food processor. A small food processor would work fine.
Okay. What are you gonna make for Christmas dinner, Katie?
What am I having for Christmas dinner? Oh, my new recipe, a fettuccine Alfredo. I'll have to give that to you, AJ, to put into the comments as well. Not that anyone's gonna, you guys already gone grocery shopping and everything, but a fettuccine Alfredo with spinach and broccoli added to the to the dressing for the sauce. And instead of noodles, I'll be doing, well, instead of pasta, I'll be doing sweet potato noodles. And it turns out so fantastic.
That sounds great. Do you use nutritional yeast?
Nutritional yeast, I do use in some of my recipes, but I'm not putting it in the Alfredo. I used to use it a lot. Well, I started 3 years on a plant-based diet without ever trying it because the food tasted so good, you didn't need it. And somehow someone convinced me to try a little bit, and then I just kept adding more and more and more. I loved it so much. But now I actually find that I don't mentally feel as good when I have it. So I try to stay away and really minimize it. But if you would like to add it, that definitely adds an umami flavor, but I don't think it's needed at all. So I have to, like I said, I'll get you the recipe for that. So we're going to add our onion here to the tomatoes. We don't need all of this. Just add a little bit. And then we're going to add in our balsamic. So this is the aged balsamic from Napa Valley Naturals. So it's 4% acidity, which means it's a little sweeter than the 6% acidity, which is standard for vinegar. But any vinegar will work here. This is the traditional though. So bruschetta is a mixture of tomatoes, garlic, basil, balsamic, and typically olive oil, but you don't need any olive oil here at all. The reason I love the aged balsamic is because it actually, opposed to the straight balsamic, it doesn't have as much tang. And that's really helpful when you're not using oil to have a vinegar that is not so, let's take this guy off. It's not so strong. So I'm mixing some in here. You can always add a little bit on top though, what I'm gonna do. And we'll mix in our basil too. Leave a little basil for garnish. Oh, it smells so good already. Now, these potatoes, when you're making these, you want to make these right before serving. So if anyone is cooking along with us, I recommend making this tomato mixture and then making the potatoes right before you serve. So even if you have them in the oven right now, I would continue cooking them on one side and then pull about, if you're not serving right away, and it's still morning in most of the country. So if you're not serving just yet, pull them out and then wait until just before serving and put them in for the second side to be cooked and then top them with your topping. Because the potatoes, once they're warmed, toasty, and then they cool, they'll get a little bit soggy and they won't be as pleasant. Okay, so next up we have our avocado here. This is optional. If you'd rather not do avocado, you can just put the potatoes directly onto, put the tomato mixture directly onto the potatoes. But typically, like I said, there's a lot of olive oil in this dish. So there's a little bit of fattiness on the lips. You feel that texture and it's really nice. And so instead we're gonna use this avocado, but it's also great because it helps to keep the tomato mixture on the potato, because potatoes don't have the absorption element like bread does. So it's a little bit, flatter surface, and the tomatoes can fall right off. So we're gonna use the avocado here to help with that. Let's pull out a spoon.
Have you ever done this with sweet potatoes? Cause you know, you can buy frozen sweet potatoes with nothing, like they're already toast.
Really? I did not know that.
Yeah, it's really cool. They have them at Sprouts and Whole Foods, and some of them have oil, but you can get them. They're literally just very thinly sliced sweet potatoes that sweet potato toast.
They already cooked, or are they just sliced for you and then you cook them?
Oh, that's a good question. When I go to the kitchen to do my demo, I'll look. I'm not sure.
Okay. Because that would make a big, I think that I'm guessing that it's kind of like the sweet potato noodles where they're raw and then you could cook them yourself. I think that would give you the best consistency. So I'm just squeezing a little bit of this lemon here into the avocado to help with the oxidization and to give us a little more flavor. Now we're gonna mix this up. So I love avocado, but when I have it on its own whole, or maybe just sliced diced up. I'll eat half an avocado and be totally satisfied. I could even do less and it would be fantastic. But if you make it into guacamole, I would eat three avocados, no problem at all, right? So when you're dicing up or smashing your avocados, keep that in mind. If you're like me and love the volume, I'd go for not mashing your avocado too much and just leaving it a little bit more whole. Okay. And if you want to add a little extra flavor here, you could do a little black pepper or garlic added to your avocado, but I like it a little bit simpler because we have so much flavor in the bruschetta already. Now my potatoes, they need to be flipped. Our timer still has 2 minutes on it, but I want to flip those and then get them going again. Fortunately, I already have some toasted up here, so I'm going to top these for you. Now we have these potatoes at a couple different sizes I wanted to show you. We have like a quarter inch here, and it's a lot flimsier than more of a half inch on a couple of these. And as they cool, they also flatten out a little bit. But these are a little bit sturdier than the quarter inch ones. So now we're just going to add in our layer on some avocado here. And this recipe, if you'd rather have this as a meal, if this isn't an appetizer, because it does make a delicious meal, you can make these on the Yukon Gold potatoes or other potatoes and just cut the potato in half and then put your toppings on it. It also works great for making stuffed potatoes, stuffed bruschetta potatoes, where if you have like a more of a russet potato that's larger, you can bake it and then take out the filling and then add in some of this avocado and bruschetta mixture. That's also a great appetizer, but a little bit larger in size. So have you done this combo, AJ? This flavor, potatoes, avocado, and tomatoes, balsamic.
Well, I mean, what could be, anytime you have potato and avocado, I mean, come on.
Yeah,
I
guess. Exactly.
Like, together or separate, they'd be amazing.
Yeah. So these.
And they're so pretty too, because red and green, because you got the green for the, you know, for Christmas, the green from the avocado and the red for Christmas. And Thomas Allen from California Balsamic is watching, and I'm sure we could take one of his on top for the, you know, too, for the drizzle. Yes. Because he has a basil flavored one.
Yeah, and even other flavors, garlic, cilantro, you can make this do so much with this, you know, these baked ingredients and just change up the flavor and you have a ton of variety. You can enjoy this all year round. Now, it'll work a little bit better if I do two hands here. So again, this is something you want to do just before serving. All this mixture, but the tomatoes and basil mixture can be made even the day before, if time is an issue. Of course, it's already Christmas Day. AJ, what are you doing for the rest of the day?
I've got another showing too. I got an inspiring show, Richard Hubbard, who just released a book. He lost 150 pounds. And then I'll take Bailey for a walk. You know, it's just quiet family time. I made a really good meal. I love doing like layered food, you know, ever since I had Jen on before Thanksgiving, where she did the, you know, the celebration strata. So like what I did is I make this stuffing without grain and it's gluten-free. And then that's one layer. And then mashed potatoes is another layer. And then cranberry sauce is another layer.
Oh my God, that sounds amazing.
Oh, it's so good. So, you know, I do cook a little bit. I'd say more, I eat pretty simply day to day, but for the holidays, this and Thanksgiving, I did make something special and I'm going to make a cranberry rice pudding from a forks over knives meal plan recipe. So I am going all out.
I'm looking forward to the fruitcake too.
It's really good because, you know, I don't do well with nuts, and almost every fruitcake has a ton of nuts and a ton of booze in it and a ton of flour. So really, this is a fruitcake.
I didn't know the booze part.
Oh, usually rum. Absolutely. So this fruitcake is actually really mostly fruit and just very little else. So you'll see. And it's actually really good. And it's good if you toast it like in the air fryer. It's like really good.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Can't wait for that. So we have our bruschetta, the toppings are all here. I just want to add two garnishes. So first, our black pepper, freshly ground black pepper makes a world of difference. Put a little bit of that on top. And then it's not in the recipe, but a little bit of nuts. You can sprinkle a little of that nutritional yeast on top if you wanted the umami, but like I said, that's more of a processed food and I'd rather not have it. So typically with bruschetta, they'd be adding a little Parmesan. Parmesan is out the door. We don't want that. But some nuts put into a little cheese grater here. So I haven't never had cheese in here, but this works fantastic for grinding up your nuts or seeds. You can do a little hemp seeds too. And then you can just sprinkle a little bit of this over top. And the walnuts, cashews, macadamia, it really looks like Parmesan cheese, freshly grated on top. So it's a really nice presentation. And just a little extra flavor, nutty umami flavor. And then if you want, you can actually store this if you do have nuts over your breakfast in the morning, you can store this in the fridge just like this and use it up, pull it out easily, use it up rather than having to put those nuts away. So here you go, your appetizer for the day. Anyone that's home cooking with us, I hope you guys enjoy this so much.
That is so beautiful. It's too bad. I wish we could somehow get a shot of all the seven chefs and the recipes together. Maybe with technology, we could do that in post-production.
I'll take a shot and send it to you.
That is beautiful. Thank you so much, Katie.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
And I wanted to also just let you know, I have a dressings cookbook, oil-free, SOS-free dressings. That's totally free. I'll share that with you, AJ, so you can put that in the comments. If anyone is looking for more recipes, I love AJ's new book, the third book that just came out with all those recipes and Chef Bravo's new course. But dressings are one thing that we could always use more of because the salads we're just eating all the time. And people love these dressings. So I'm going to give you that, guys, for free. And I hope you enjoy the bruschetta and have a wonderful rest of your holiday feast.
Thank you so much, Katie Mae. You're adorable and your food is beautiful, as are you. And thanks for being here also at Thanksgiving, just like Ramses.
Yes.
I jingle. All right. Well, on to the next chef. Boy, we're getting everybody that has ever worked at True North and McDougal all at the very top of the show. So our next chef would have been here for the holiday Thanksgiving, but she was out of the country and she was worried that maybe the Wi-Fi wouldn't work. So, but she's here today and she's going to be, what would a holiday be without cranberry relish, right? And her name is CATHY Fisher and she's from Straight Up Food. She's been on the show many times. She also goes live weekly, just like Katie Mae. You can find out all about her at straightupfood.com. She is a big cat lover and she fosters kitties all the time, which I think is so great. I love when people love animals. Please welcome for the first time in the cook along, CATHY Fisher. Thanks for being here on Christmas.
Hi, AJ. Thank you for having me. Can you hear me okay?
I can hear you and I can see you.
Yay. Okay. Thank you so much. So this is my raw cranberry relish and it's super easy to make. It only has 6 ingredients and it comes together very quickly in the food processor. I did want to mention that cranberries and the fuyu persimmons are kind of at the end of their season right now. And I forget that every year when I go out to look for these for Christmas. So this is super ideal for Thanksgiving or after because these are just coming into season, but they were still around. They're just kind of the end of the season. So if you're gonna make this for your holiday Christmas meal, maybe just go, don't wait till the last minute because your fresh cranberries and your fuyus might be gone by then, but I was able to find them. So let's do this. I already started chopping a few things here, but the recipe is, and let me go in order, 1.5 cups of fresh cranberries, and I have them measured out here. And I've never tried it with frozen cranberries. I think some other people have, and they said it works fine. It's a little more thinner, waterier, because when those frozen cranberries thaw, they just get a little wetter. But use the fresh ones if you can find them. And they come in, here's my little bag. They just come in a little bag like this. It takes about a half of a bag and you'll find these in the produce section usually. So 1.5 cups fresh cranberries. And then next we are gonna put in a fuyu persimmon. two of these. And I already cut one up and I put it in there, but I thought I would show you how I cut these. So I just cut it in half. And by the way, these are fuyu. They look like orange tomatoes. There are other kind of persimmons out there like hai chia and amagaki. Don't use the hai chia. That's more for baking. The amagaki is a little more oblong, and you can use that instead of the fuyu if that's all you can find, but amagakis are delightful. So fuyus or amagakis would work. And you do want to get them while they're firm, like an apple. If they're all soft, I mean, that would still work. It would just be a little gooier, softer. All right, so just cut it in half. And then I just cut this center part out completely, and that gets the stem and everything. And then just, you know, it's going in the food processor, so it doesn't have to be cut super small, but just kind of large bite-sized pieces maybe. And I have the S blade in here in my food processor, which is the most common blade of the food processor. If you don't have a food processor, you don't want to use a blender. That's going to blend things up a little bit too much. It's going to be like salad dressing, and we don't quite want that. If you don't have a food processor, just cut everything really small with your chef's knife, and that would work too. All right, so that's two fuyus in there, and then two tangerines, and I forget if these are clementines. I think they are. I bought a bag of them. They're super easy to peel. You could use any kind of tangerine. Try to get the kind that don't have the seeds in them, because then you won't have to pick out the seeds. See how easily these peel? I just love them. So these are the seedless. I already have one in here. Just break them up a little bit. If you can't find a tangerine, you can use an orange. That's fine. All right, then we're gonna put in an apple. I have two here. This is a Granny Smith and this is a Honeycrisp. I like to use a green in here because there's already lots of orange and red. But you could also use a Honeycrisp that has green and red on it. But I'm going to go ahead and do the Granny Smith. But any kind of apple would work, really. And then just cut it into slices like this. And move those seeds out. And then again, kind of like the persimmons, just chunky bite-sized pieces. Don't have to peel your apple. And if you want, but you don't have to. If you didn't have an apple, you could also use a bosque pear. That would be really good, or in addition to. And really there's lots of options with this dish. Think of things that are usually in cranberry relish that you might want to add, like some chopped walnuts or some raisins or some chopped dates. Now you might be thinking that raw cranberries are going to be a little bit too tart, but they're not. When they're paired with the apple, which is sweet, and the persimmon and the tangerine, it all kind of balances out really nicely. But yeah, you could use a pear, you could throw in some raisins. I have little notes here. What else? Some orange, I already said that, lemon zest, raspberries, pomegranate seeds, which I'm gonna put on toward the end. Okay, so that's all of our fruit.
What are you making for Christmas? What are you eating for Christmas? What are you gonna have for Christmas?
I think I'm having tacos today. nothing super special, actually. Just chilling out at home. All right, so a half teaspoon of cinnamon. And this is just my ground Ceylon true cinnamon that I get from Savory Spice. And then we're also going to do a half teaspoon of nutmeg. You can use the pre-ground nutmeg, or you can use whole nutmegs, which I tend to use a lot. And they're very hard. They're like little rocks. So you want to use your microplane to just grate a little bit on your cutting board until I get to about a half teaspoon. All right, and then use your bench scraper, your pastry scraper to pick it up. I think that is everything. Yep, all right. So now we're just gonna blend it all together and we're gonna pulse it like 10 or 15 times. This is kind of like salsa, chunky salsa is what we're looking for here. What am I doing here? Okay. Oh, there we go. All right, so we're just gonna keep an eye on this while we pulse it. We don't want it to go too far, but we want it to look like a chunky salsa or a chunky relish. Whoops, I'm not plugged in. That would be helpful.
I always find when you plug your equipment in, it works better. It's something I actually learned a long time ago. Did you get your kitties any presents for Christmas? So we got one for Bailey.
I did not get them any presents for Christmas. I got them, I'm gonna have to scoot this over. I did not plan this very well. My extension cord is plugged into something else. All right. Can you see this? I think you can still see this.
I can see it.
Okay. And then about halfway through, go ahead and get your spatula and scrape it down a little. And I'll show you what this looks like in a sec. Oh, that looks so pretty already. Now with food processors, sometimes things get caught in the bottom a little bit. So that's why I'm kind of helping it and turning it over, looking for any big chunks and kind of moving them up. So we'll give it a little bit more.
That's what I like about the Nutri-Milk machine, because in addition to the blade, it's got these other thing and you don't have to do that. It does it for you. It's like automatic. Kind of cool.
Oh, I saw that. That looked really cool.
Yeah. So that's what I like about it. I don't have to keep opening the top because I'm lazy.
No, I like that.
Is it cold where you are?
Yeah. Well,
you're right.
California cold.
Yeah.
It cut down. I'm going on in a few minutes. I'll call you up at the end.
Hey, Christina,
I can take him.
Hey, mute yourself, Christina. Oh, we got another chef in that. Okay. There we go. Sorry about that, Kathy.
That's quite a feat, AJ, that you're doing today, juggling all of us different chefs and having us in the on deck waiting. And
you know, it's like being a real television producer. And this is the first time that I'm participating. So I got to run from here to there and try to figure out the technology. I always wondered like how Clint Eastwood and Barbara Streisand, how they star and direct the movie at the same time. So I'm wearing many different hats, including my goofy hat today.
That reminds me, I just watched a movie that was starred George Clooney. It's on Netflix and it he's the director as well. Did you see that one?
Is it the new one where he's out in the snow or something?
It's like in space, but
is it good? It didn't get a good review on Rotten Tomatoes, so how is it? Should I watch it?
Not good.
Okay, yeah, it got a really got like 29. So instead we started watching The Prom last night with Meryl Streep. And I mean, she can do no wrong. I mean, I love her. She's I'm loving that movie.
I should check that out. Yeah, well, you know, I was really bummed because I like space movies and I like George Clooney, and this was not the best. It looked good, had good music, but it was just a downer movie.
Anyway. Who wants a downer during a pandemic or during Christmas? So I want feel good stuff.
Yeah.
And feel good food. And when you eat SOS free, guys, you feel good.
Right. All right. So I transferred all that out of the food processor. Sometimes I'll put it into a bowl. Like I have my cute bowl. But sometimes I'll just put it into a bowl to give it, you know, a final mix here. And, you know, to make sure the cinnamon and the nutmeg and everything is mixed in. And you know what? There's always that one piece that just did not fall in line and that is big and chunky. So you can leave it in or take it out. So this is, you know, like a holiday side dish. So I like to put it in a cute dish. I don't know if it'll all fit in this dish. Oh, making a big mess over here. Okay. So that looks good. Okay. clean as we go. And then, so can you kind of see that?
It's gorgeous.
Yeah, pretty colors. You can leave yours a little chunkier than that if you want. And then this is optional. You can put some pomegranate seeds on top just for a little pretty garnish. Yeah, or you can put it on the side and people can add their own if they want. And that is it. I probably made that look much harder than it is. I'll walk it up a little closer just to see if that helps anything.
You know, I bet that would be good on oatmeal.
Oh yeah, and that's in my notes actually of my recipe, that if you have leftover of this, put it on top of your green salad. You can put it over your oatmeal. What is it? Oh, you can blend it into green smoothies. Or you can really put it in your Vitamix and make a salad dressing out of it. Maybe add a little bit of vinegar or lemon juice or something like that. So nothing has to go to waste.
All right. Such a great, I think I see a kitty off to the side.
That's Gigi. She insists on, because this is her kitty tree right here. So she's wondering why it's in the kitchen. She's my newest kitty. She's not as used to all this filming stuff.
Oh, well, we'll have to get her in that. Well, thank you so much. That looks absolutely easy, delicious, and healthy. I really appreciate it. And happy holidays and Merry Christmas, Cathy. Yes, thank you for your friendship and for all you do to make healthy delicious.
Thank you.
You're so welcome. Make sure to go to Straight Up Food and subscribe to Cathy's blog and to watch her daily wonderful YouTube presentations. Our next chef was also here for Thanksgiving, and she is adorable. I love her voice as much as I love her food. She is going to be making soup this time. So Carole, if you'd like to unmute yourself and put yourself on camera, you are next. Yeah, I can see her doing it. And her name is Carole Levy. Her company is The Veggie Vanguard. I met her in New York last time that I was in New York, when we were able to travel at the JCC in Manhattan. And she was my sous chef, but really she could have done the whole thing. She's extraordinary in the kitchen. She's a wonderful natural teacher, and she does SOS free absolutely beautifully and deliciously. Please welcome back with butternut soup, Carole Levy.
Oh, thanks, AJ. Merry Christmas and hello, everyone. And I think I mentioned to you, AJ, that I was traveling, and I'm actually not in New York at all. I'm in Taos, New Mexico. So I'm in a little tiny little casita, Birch Street Casitas, and it's I've kind of made everything work here. I don't have any of my own equipment. I brought a few trusted things with me, but you know, when you're in a brand new kitchen, you have to make things work. So don't have any of my own pots. In fact, I had to borrow a pot from Jim and Nancy, and they gave me a pick of the copper pot, which I love so much. But we're gonna start our soup, and it's a fairly simple soup. And almost everything goes in at one time, but we're gonna get the stove, and I always like getting the pot hot. So before we start sauteing the onions, so this is our pot here, and we're getting that hot. I have already prepped 1 cup of diced onion in it. I've small diced it, but honestly, this entire soup is gonna get pureed in a blender or with an immersion blender. So nothing has to be perfect, okay? Things can be chunky and things don't have to look all unified because we're ultimately gonna blend it so it's all smooth. These are our onions. I've also started to prep the butternut squash, but I wanted to show some of it. This was a gigantic butternut squash. It was like up to here. It has a neck. This butternut squash has a long neck. This particular one had a long neck. And then usually it fans out at the bottom and this is where the seeds are. Okay. So we're going to want to get rid of those. We need 4 cups total for the butternut squash. And you can't always buy, I wrote in the recipe, you need 2 pounds, but you need approximately 4 cups. So what you're gonna do is I've already cut the neck off of it and cut up 2 cups right here. And we need to peel off this skin. And it's pretty much like carving if you were having a melon, and you wanna take a good sharp knife. And sometimes you can take a peeler. This peeler is not the best, but it is possible actually, if you had a good peeler, to really give it a real peel. But I try never to, it doesn't really work that well. And I prefer ultimately using the knife. So what we're gonna do is gonna always cut with this as a flat bottom so it's not rolling around. And we want to just take our knife and run it along the curvature of the pump, of the squash. Okay, so I'm just cutting. Now, I also like not to throw all of this things away. Whenever I'm making a soup, whatever's going in the soup actually becomes my stock. Now, of course, you don't have to be making stock yourself. You could buy the box, you know, a good brand of a stock that is in a box, but make sure that you try to buy it with no sodium or very low sodium, because when you're purchasing stock, it's often very salty. And sometimes the flavor, sometimes I feel like all they do in those box stocks is they put carrots in it. And I don't know, it looks awfully orange. So what I did this morning when I had cut a bunch of this, I had in a pot, in a big stock pot, I actually put these skins. I had these skins. I trimmed my onion. I was had a little ginger. I had a few extra mushrooms in the refrigerator. So this all made stock. And I even used the peel of the apple that we're going to put inside the soup and made a big, here's the stock here. And I just drained it and I cooked that stock for like an hour and a little bit. But ultimately all of this is gonna get composted. If I were home, I would be composting, but there's no composting happening in my little casita where I am. But we'll just throw that out. But I do like kind of always having a tip when I'm cutting a lot of vegetables is to have something to put all the kind of garbagey things that you're not actually eating. So it's not just sitting around, it's actually going into a container so that you can dump it, whether it's the garbage or into the compost. So that's gonna go over there. And this pot is getting hot, and I know that because I can feel it, but I always put a little bit of water in it, and then it starts to sizzle, and I'm listening, and that pan is ready to go for our water sauteing or broth sauteing, either one, but we have broth. So we're gonna put these onions in, okay? And then we're going to add just a little teeny bit of broth, okay? We don't wanna add a ton of broth because you don't wanna drown your onions. Again, we're not using any oil in this recipe. So but these onions could get brown, could caramelize. Right now, we're just gonna try to make them so they're translucent, which requires them to cook for about 5 to 7 minutes. So those are gonna cook for a few minutes while we get the rest of the things prepped. And a little tip I wanna show you, I love doing this, and if you actually have a drawer that's near your stove and you need more counter, I just put this nice little cutting board here, and I love it. It's given me another little tabletop, which is good when you're short space, you know, when you have to adapt. Now that's a very hard pumpkin, and I end up with this, and these are the seeds. Okay, and what I usually do is I get a bowl, and I always get a big spoon, and in this case, I'm gonna use a tablespoon, and you want to just get those seeds out of there, okay? And you just, there's a lot of string here, and it can get a little bit messy, and I just wanted to be able to show you how you're gonna do this. These seeds are actually edible, and I like saving them actually and cooking them. And what I do, so here's a clean pumpkin, okay? And I thought it was important to show you that because not every person understands that. You can also buy pumpkin in a lot of stores, just have it already cubed. Then I actually like buying it like that because sometimes butternut squash is a little bit of a pain. And I like buying just the pre-made cut, which is really pretty ideal. And if you were to eat these, you would soak them in a bunch of water. I would put them in water. And then ultimately, you're going to get all those stringy pumpkin part off, and you would put them on a sheet pan and cook them in a slow oven. But these are definitely edible, so try not to throw them away because they're good on salads and other things. So I'm going to just put those off to the side. Let's continue to stir our onions. Okay, those are cooking away very nicely. And we're going to get the remaining parts of our pumpkin cut. And let me just get that cut here. We are gonna get the 4 cups total. So again, this is all rough chop. We don't have to, and I'm gonna make it kind of like big 1-inch cubes, okay? It's kind of have to wrestle with it, and sometimes pumpkin can be just, and I'm cutting this, and they're big chunks, okay? And I am gonna put this here, and we're gonna cut the garlic up, the garlic, and this is, we're not gonna need all this pumpkin, so I'm gonna save this for another time. So we'll just put that off to the side. And then you wanna try to make everything as uniform. It doesn't have to be perfect. I said we're doing rough chop, but you wanna make it so that all the pieces are kind of cooking at the well at the same time, so that they're all roughly the same. So that's our, this right here is gonna be our 4 cups of pumpkin, okay? And I also, we need to get the garlic, and let's get, and it doesn't have to be exact. It can be a little bit more, a little bit less. And we need garlic. And it was disappointing this morning when I actually opened my garlic. I talk about this all the time. As a cook, you have to learn what a normal clove of garlic looks like, right? Because sometimes they're like gigantic. Sometimes they're the right size, medium. But today when I opened a huge head of garlic, they were all these little baby ones, little tiny ones, which, you know, I just like was like, oh, I was just like, I couldn't believe, like, why are you doing this to me? So I said in the recipe that we need 3 to 4 cloves of garlic. But what I did was I kind of said, okay, 2 of these are going to be 1, 2 of these are going to be 2, 2 of these are going to equal 3, and this would be the 4th. You know, so that's kind of, so basically I have 2, 4, 6, 8. I have 8 cloves of garlic, but I only said use 3. That's because you have to know what a normal size garlic looks like. And these are so small, and it means you have to get all the paper. And what I'm just doing is I'm putting all my weight on the knife, and we don't have to really chop these so much. Okay. It's really not necessary because again, we're going to put everything into the machine. So why am aggravated by all this, and let's just get this particular bucket that I like putting all my scraps in. I just, it means that you have to unwrap all these, and it means that your fingers are full of paper. And if you just had 4 nice cloves of garlic, you wouldn't have to be getting all these under out of their little skins. And let me get this, make sure that nothing's sticking here. We are in good shape with the onions. And the other things that we're going to be putting in at the same time are we're going to have rosemary and sage. That's our primary flavoring in this particular soup. And those, all those papers, just make sure everything is out. Okay, everything is out. Okay, that is good. And that is, like I said, a little bit aggravating, but that is the way it is when you don't know what the garlic. And I'm just going to give these like a rough chop. You can mince them, but it really isn't important to mince them. Really isn't, because we're gonna blend everything. So that's our rough chop of those. Then we also need garlic, I mean ginger. And this is the ginger, that big piece of ginger that I have. I always try to look for the fattest, biggest ginger with not too many knobs, so you're not wasting too many things. And there are 2 ways of going about peeling ginger. You can actually take a spoon and then give it a good, start to scrape it like that. And that's one way. You can also take a peeler to it and get, but this I prefer a littler spoon, but I didn't have a littler spoon. I like a little espresso spoon to do this, actually. But we don't need all of this. And all these little pieces actually are good for the stock. But we only need 1 inch, okay? 1 inch of a big chunk here is what I'm doing. And I'm just going to actually peel it with my knife. And try not to throw away, if you've washed your knife, I mean, I just cut garlic, so you don't want to do this, but if you're just peeling the ginger for the, you know, with a clean wash knife, this is delicious. These peels I always save and make hot tea, you know, with a little lemon and a little turmeric and ginger, and I think they're just absolutely delicious. So it's not garbage, you know, you've tried to try to use everything. So these are very yummy in the tea. I'm gonna leave these off to the side. And then that's our 1-inch chunk. And what I'm gonna do is just slice this, and we're gonna get this also in all at the same time, okay? And I'm giving it all a rough chop, not mince, nothing. So this now is all ready to go into the with the onions. And let's just get this in, and I'm going to pick this up and get this all in with the onions. And I'll show you what that looks like just so you are familiar. Let's get a spoon, give this a stir. Nothing is sticking in this pot. It's amazing. It's really good. So you're going to cook the ginger and the garlic till it doesn't smell raw anymore, which is just a very few minutes, okay? Not very long. Okay, and I'm just going to show you that nothing is burning, okay? Nothing, and it's cooking away. It's being translucent. You know, it's a little bit magical when people think, oh, you can't caramelize onions. We're not caramelizing these, but if you let these cook for a long enough time, the sugars would release and you would get beautiful caramelized onions. The next thing that we're going to do is we have rosemary, fresh rosemary, and we need approximately a half a tablespoon. And I just wanted to show you, this is beautiful rosemary, and much like kale, you do the same thing. It has a stem and you want to just push it backwards, okay? Push it backwards and you end up stripping it all. Some little leaves. Now, this is really delicious. Talking about saving things, sometimes I save these stems and I put it in my rice when I'm cooking or my quinoa because it really flavors. Just like when you're trimming basil, you never throw away those stems because it's so aromatic and so very beautiful, so beautiful. So we're gonna just chop this up. Again, rough chop. I'm gonna just roughly chop it. Doesn't have to be so fine. And this is one of our main flavorings, the fresh rosemary. And all of you that are in California and have it growing in your yard, I'm so jealous. When I lived in California, I loved just going outside and rosemary was everywhere, in the bank parking lots or in people's homes. It was just ground cover. And now I have to buy it in little containers. So this rosemary is going in. And the other spice that we need, the other spices that we need to have sage. And I wanted to show you, because I mentioned that I'm traveling, that I actually brought my own spices with me while I'm traveling. And I put them in tiny little bags. I deemed these to be my things that I would need if I were in a kitchen. And I brought, probably a dozen things like garlic and onion and oregano and black pepper, and I always need cumin seeds, and it seems like you always need cinnamon. And these are just little tiny bags that I used to take my vitamins in. And now this time here's chili powder. So we need sage. So that way when I came here, I didn't have to buy a bunch of spices. I just had them in my suitcase. And airport security definitely stopped me. And I just said, you know what? I'm cooking while I'm traveling and I need these spices. And sure enough, he told me a big story about how he loves to cook. And before I knew it, I was pushed through and no problems at security. So I'm going to get this. We need to have one tablespoon of sage. And that's pretty much what I have left in here because I made this, made the pot of soup earlier and I've used a bunch of. This is going in. I'm just going to put all of the sage in because it is one tablespoon left in here. It means I won't have any more sage while I'm here, but that's fine. And you could use fresh sage. Sometimes, you know, it's easy to find. And let's just get a little bit more stock in here. Okay, and that is looking delicious. Really, really, it smells so aromatic. I cannot tell you. I wish you were here. I wish we had smell TV. So this is what this looks like. And then what's going to go in here now? The rest of the ingredients all at one time. So we're putting in our 4 cups of butternut squash right in to the, and if you had an Instapot, again, you could put everything in at one time, everything. And we need our apples. Now, sometimes I use pears. You can use apples or pears. It doesn't matter. This time I used apples. This is one cut apple. And I'll show you how we cut that. And then we need four to five cups of stock. And I'm just going to measure it here. I have it here. I usually just pour it and eye it because ultimately it doesn't really need measuring. You're just out to cover all of your squash. There's two. That's two. And this is going to be four. Okay, and I'm going to put a little more because I know I see that it needs a little more. And I just basically covered, what I've done is I covered the squash and the apples. And we need to still get one more apple in there. And I'm going to put this on high so it starts to boil. And we are going to just cut one apple because I wanted to show you how to do that. And I'm just going to get it peeled. And again, I'm going to bring back my garbagey pot. And when I made stock this morning, AJ, I actually put this apple peel into the stock. And it just, again, it adds flavor. And I think it's really nice to do that. And I always, if I'm making apple pie or something, I always save all the skin and then I boil it. And sometimes you, and I even put the core into the stock. So we've already made our stock. So again, you don't have to make your stock. So that is that. And that's how you, obviously you know how to peel an apple. And then what I do is I cut it in half, cut it again into quarters. Okay. And then you want to get out the seed and the core. So I just take my knife at an angle and just lightly try to cut that out, trying not to get any of the seed in there. And this actually, again, goes into the garbage. And we take that out. And I'm just going to do this really quickly for you so you see how to get all that core out. And again, these cores are going in this bowl. And you do get, sometimes you get little seeds on your cutting board. You have to make sure that those aren't going into your food. And then you're just going to rough chop these. And I'm just going to chop them the same, basically the same size. So I'm taking the quarter and cutting it in half. And then I'm cutting it into the thirds. So half and then into thirds. That way everything in the pot is the same size and it's all going to cook together. The other way to make this soup, I just want to mention to you that I do often, is I take a sheet pan and I turn the oven on to like 400 degrees and I put mine a sheet pan with parchment paper and I put all the ingredients, the apples, the butternut squash, the onions, and I put it in the oven and I actually let it cook and let it get deeper. When you roast things, it gets deeper flavor. But that's a step that I just wanted to mention to you, but you certainly don't have to do that. Okay, and we've got everything and I always check the recipe, okay? I have the recipe here and I make sure that we've done everything. We had apples and squash and onions and garlic, ginger, sage, rosemary, broth. And eventually we're gonna put some black pepper and garnish it. So I'm gonna put a little bit of black pepper in now. We might have to top off. And I have my own little black pepper that I ground nicely before I left, a big container of it. And then the lid goes on this and it boils. Now, if I were home, I would definitely puree this with an immersion blender. But I'm not home and I didn't bring an immersion blender with me. So you could puree this. The best way is the immersion blender because you can puree the soup while it's still hot. Now, if you don't have an immersion blender, which is a stick blender that you plug in and you go zzz, zzz, and you blend it till it's perfectly smooth. And you're gonna do that once everything is soft. You know, you're just gonna put a fork into the squash and to the apple and make sure everything's soft. And that's when you're gonna blend everything. But if you don't have an immersion blender, then let the soup cool off and then transfer it to either your blender, your Vitamix, or your food processor. But just be very, very careful when you're transferring. I sometimes don't wait, I'm very impatient, and I'll just take the hot soup and I'll start pouring it into the blender. And so just be careful because it is hot liquid, and if for any reason when you're blending, you don't want it to overflow and you don't, you just wanna be really smart about it and not let yourself get touched by any hot liquid. So we have already pureed the soup. The other thing that I want to do is we're gonna garnish this soup with pepitas, which are little green pumpkin seeds. And you can roast these in the oven on a sheet pan, or right now I have this little pan. It's kind of a funky pan to tell you the truth. But I'm gonna just put these in, just a few of them. And I usually garnish the soup with pepitas and pomegranates. And when I left New York, pomegranates were still in season, but here in Taos, I could not find one pomegranate to save my life. So I've kind of been thinking for the last day, like, well, how am I going to garnish the soup and what is it going to look like? So you'll see that I've come up with a couple different ideas. One of the ideas, and this soup, I actually want to get covered. So I don't have a lid here for this particular pot. So I'm just using an upside down plate, which is good. And also, and back here is the soup. It's already pureed. It's already beautiful. And I can hear the pizza starting to pop. Okay. And I'm just going to give them a little bit of a jiggle. I reduced and made a nice syrup for our drizzle. So I suggest that there are different ways to finish the soup. You can put white or black beans in the soup to add a little extra protein. You could put wild rice in the soup, which would be absolutely delicious. I hear these popping, I'm just moving those. You could also so any kind of grain would be delicious in the soup, or any kind of bean. And of course, if you're buying the canned beans, you wanna buy them with no salt and make sure that they're drained and washed. And then you would add the beans to the pot and that would be delicious. I believe Katie may have the nice balsamic vinegar, the aged balsamic, but I didn't have any of that here. So I just took a regular balsamic, a kind of inexpensive one that I had that was here in the casita. And I put it in this pot. And I put a bunch of it, maybe like a cup of it, and I reduced it, and I actually got a beautiful syrup. That just takes a very few minutes to do that. So that's gonna be our swirl. These are toasted and smoking, so I better get those. It's a very thin pot. They're brown, and they look fantastic and ready to go. And we're gonna, so again, this soup is gonna boil, come to a boil, and then I will blend it. But we've got our other soup right here, and we're gonna be ready to serve it. And I have a ladle. I don't have a ladle, so I'm using a measuring cup. Again, you have to be resourceful. And this soup looks delicious. It's very hot. And I'm gonna put 2 cups. 2 cups is a pretty normal serving, actually. I'm gonna give it a little bit more because these bowls are very deep, okay? And then, it's hard to see because this bowl is so high. I decided to cut up a little bit of purple sweet potato and I'm putting that on top. Okay, I just made, just cut up a little bit. And then I have my little swirl. We're gonna put a swirl and I'm just gonna swirl this along the top like this, just a little bit of sweetness added. And then we're going to put our pepitas. And these are very hot, so I'm just taking them and putting just a very few. They kind of like to sink to the bottom. Again, if you have the pomegranates for Christmas, the pepitas and the pomegranates look very festive. And that is our bowl of soup, and I'm just going to show it to you without trying to spill the soup, because I don't want to spill the soup. That would not be good. But that is the soup, and I think it's, I like to mix it up a little bit. And then I always, it's actually very delicious. So wow. That's everything. And it's just super simple.
That's super amazing. Simple. And I know how difficult it is to cook in an unfamiliar kitchen. So thank you so much. You are just such a wonderful teacher.
Thank you, AJ, for having me. And I wish everyone a happy holiday.
Thank you so much. And her wonderful recipe is in the show notes. If you're watching on YouTube, if you're watching on Facebook, hop over to YouTube and you will see the recipe. Thanks so much. Happy holidays, Carole.
Bye. Bye-bye.
Take care. So our next chef, this will be her first time, not on my show, but participating in the multi-chef extravaganza. Her name is Chef Christina Martin. I met her at Summerfest many years ago because she is just wonderful. She volunteers there and she just gets the kitchen running and gets the demos coordinated. And she's going to be making something that's going to be delicious. I know it's not only SOS-free, but it's got two of my favorite things. It's got cauliflower and it's got millet. Please welcome Chef Christina. It looks like she's holding a friend.
Hi.
Hi, Theo says, happy holidays. We wanted to wish you and Bailey and everyone else a happy holidays. And I have to show you real quick. This was his Christmas gift. It's a little doggy sweatshirt.
He's so adorable. And it looks like somebody got an air fryer for Christmas,
yes,
too.
Yes, I wanted to show you. Recommended by you. My family got me that.
That is so nice.
I'm
going
to pull this over to the kitchen. So you're going to have to bend down, I guess. This. Sorry, hold on. Let me change this box.
No worries.
All right, here we go.
Millet to me is such, I'm so thankful you're using millet because I'm going to be using it in my dessert too, because it is such an underused grain. People think of it as birdseed, which it is, but it's so delicious. And especially people that are afraid to eat rice, eat millet. It's very toothsome. It's so yummy and it's gluten-free.
Exactly. And it's gluten-free. And when I went to the supermarket one time, they did tell me to look in the bird food aisle when I was looking for it, and I couldn't find it in a grocery that I was at. But I'm making two dishes. I'm going to do them pretty quick because they're pretty easy to make. And my thing with the holidays is as much as I love to cook, I'd rather spend time with the family, and we're going to watch movies later. And so I want to show you how to make this cauliflower mash and a mushroom onion gravy. So this can be done ahead of time. Day before, we're going to soak our millet the day before. Now, most of the time on holidays, people's favorite dish is always mashed potatoes, right? Most of the people love sides for the holidays, but mashed potatoes often have butter and heavy cream and salt. And although they're a vegetable, they have all that other added stuff that we really don't want to be eating. So this dish is, and I've been eating it while I was watching all the other chefs. So I ate a bunch of it already, but I want to show you how to do it. So I soak the millet overnight just in some water. So water covered, and I put a towel over the bowl. So I soaked this yesterday. So then we're going to add this into our pot. All right. So into our millet is going to go our cauliflower. Now, cauliflower this time of year is a little expensive. I have to admit, the head of cauliflower I got in the regular grocery was $5. But you can make this all year round as well. We are going to slice the cauliflower. I sliced it really thin. That's going to go into our pot. And even the stem too I used, I just broke off the green part. I cut it in half and then sliced it really thin. And then some fresh garlic. So if you love garlic, you might want to add two cloves, but for this recipe, it's one clove. And what we're going to do is we're going to bring this up to a boil. Once it hits boil, we're going to put a lid on it and let it simmer for 30 to 40 minutes. We want that millet to cook and get soft, because after that, once that comes, and the magic of TV, Chef AJ, can you see the stove?
I can, yes.
Okay. So I have a pot that's already been cooked this morning. I cooked it, and then I used my KitchenAid. So I have this for 25 years. It's just the old fashioned kind of beaters. And then you can also use a stick blender or immersion blender. You just want to mash it until it's blended, until it's nice and smooth and creamy. Now, if it's not garlicky enough for you, you can use garlic powder, onion powder can be added too. Last chef was talking about all the spices that she carries with her. You can use different spices in your mash as well. So that I'm going to put off to the side. I'm actually going to heat it. I'm going to keep that on low and heat that. And the next thing is we're going to make our mushroom onion gravy, which is pretty easy. I have to admit, it doesn't cook for hours. It's a very quick recipe. I have my onions already sliced and my mushrooms already sliced. And you can do all different kinds of mushrooms. It doesn't have to be cremini, or you can use some button. I would do a mixture. I love oyster mushrooms. So any kind of mushroom you can use in that. And then we're going to add a little bit of stock to our pan. Now you can use stock or water. You can use a combination. Again, you want to look for if you're going to buy a box stock, you want to look for a low sodium or no sodium stock, or you can make it yourself, or you can use water with this as well. So we're just going to put enough to the little coat, start to coat the pan. And then we have some thin sliced mushrooms, onions, they're going to go in. And then our mushrooms that we sliced up.
There's a question, do you soak millet? I don't soak my millet.
I did soak it.
You do, but do you have to? But do you have to soak it?
No. Mm-mm. It just cuts the cooking time.
I see. That's a good reason. That's a good reason. But it's not like you have to soak it because it's like got some weird
for the enzymes or anything. Yeah, like no, you don't have to do it for any of that reason.
Right. Because I know with quinoa, there's like supposedly a toxin called saponin that if you don't soak it,
Right. So my mushrooms and my onions are in the pan. Now I have stock in there. So it's more of this is a simmer. It's not a saute because a saute is when we use oil and high heat. So this is more of a simmer. We're going to simmer. We're not going to get much color because, again, we don't have any oil in the pan. There's no oil, no salt in this. But it's going to take about 5 to 7 minutes. That's it. To get these mushrooms wilted, to get the onions a little, they get a little caramelization, but not much. They just more get soft. All right. So once... Sorry. So we're going to let them simmer in the pan until they cook down. The mushrooms are going to get soft. The mushrooms are going to get soft. And then what I'm going to walk you through it for time's sake too. Sure. Thank you. We are going to make a slurry. Now to make a slurry, you use cornstarch and water. I have a little bit of water here. And this is going to help thicken it. You can use arrowroot too, which is also a natural thickener if you don't want to use cornstarch. I'm going to set this aside. My mushrooms and onions are cooking. It smells really good in the house when you have, you know, mushrooms and onions cooking, right?
Yeah, mushrooms are great. Mushrooms have to be cooked according to Dr. Furman. You're not supposed to eat them raw.
They're raw, no. No, I never liked the taste of them raw in a salad. So, and they cook very quick. They cook very quickly. So, what you're going to do is once they cook down, I'll show you the other pot. I don't know if you guys can see. I'll show you. So they're about halfway done right there. I'm going to bring this pan over. This pan already has the slurry added to it. I just want to heat it up some. So as you can see, we also added some fresh thyme. So, which is classic, kind of classic French cuisine here, thyme and mushrooms. So when you have thyme, you want to take the stalk, take one that's, and you want to run your fingers down it so that you get the leaves. A little. So you take it like this, and then you just run your fingers opposite the leaves, and then they come right off like that. So we add some fresh thyme. We added our slurry, and we let it cook for about 5 minutes to thicken it. So now we went from that thin stock to this. Nice gravy.
Nice.
Okay. Now I'm going to show us how to plate this. So for the holiday, I would have this with some maybe Brussels sprouts, some corn.
Is that what you're going to have for dinner tonight or lunch?
Yeah. Lunch? Yep. I'm going to have for Christmas. We'll eat around 4 o'clock Eastern time here. All right. All right. Now, if you like black pepper, you can put some black pepper on this as well. All
Yep. What's a holiday without gravy, right?
Yes. We'll clean up our plate because our presentation.
I can tell you're a real chef when you clean your plate, you know you're a real chef.
All right, we're gonna put some fresh parsley on here. And what's really great if you have it from your garden, like, you know, this time of year we're drying out some herbs, and I have some basil left from the garden. I guess I'm not sure how cold it is out where you are, but there's our plate.
Oh my God, that looks like a restaurant.
Cauliflower mash. Now, I've always made cauliflower mash. This is the first time I actually put millet in it when I talked to you about doing the show, because I just usually do use cauliflower plain. I don't put a protein in it. But then I thought about it. I'm like, for the SOS show, I'm like, well, I'm going to put a protein in it so that we get protein. We have a grain in it. And there you go.
That looks like I could eat that for a meal. That looks amazing.
I know, Christina. Right? And then with some, I'm going to put corn with mine. I have Brussels sprouts ready. I'm going to start prepping them next. I'm going to put Brussels sprouts with this for myself, and some corn and cranberry. I always eat all the sides. I've always have most people, when you give them a survey of what they like best about a holiday meal, they never say the turkey. They always say all the sides, sweet potatoes, you know, cranberry, stuffing, you know, and all that stuff can be made plant-based, and it can all be made SOS. And be delicious.
You're so good. Why don't you ever present at Summerfest? Why do they hide you in the kitchen? You're a great chef.
Because I don't have a book. Yes, that's why.
Well, then I guess you're going to have one.
I'm working on it. I'm trying my hardest. And, I'm trying. So if anybody knows anybody.
Well, I'll help you. Nancy says, is there a substitute for millet? Why? Millet's amazing. And nobody's allergic to millet.
You can't even really taste it in there. You really can't. I don't want to turn the plate. It's like sliding, but do it this way. I'll post a picture of it. But this is half the recipe. Actually, half of that recipe made this whole pot. And so that was one head of cauliflower. I moved it to a smaller pot because I made it this morning. Me and the kids were watching Aladdin, and then I did the prep, and then had everything ready for you guys. But it's really quick. I mean, to make a gravy that fast, it is really fast. You can do this meal in under a half hour. Other than the millet and the cauliflower, it really took 30 to 40 minutes to cook, to get soft before I could blend it. That's the reason why you cook it so long, is just so that you can blend it easy.
Somebody's asking if you could also blend the mushroom gravy if you wanted to.
Sure. I would say, why not? Yeah. If you have Vitamix, put in your Vitamix.
Nice.
Yep. If you don't want chunky, I like the mushrooms. Like, I like it chunky like that. And you can garnish it with whatever vegetable you want or herb that you like. Always garnish your stuff with something fresh. It kind of brings the plate alive. If I didn't have that, I mean, the green makes it festive looking, especially if I would have put some corn or cranberry on this plate as well, would really look, you know, give it some color and really look pretty. Because we eat with our eyes, right?
Absolutely. I got to just interrupt for a second. It's Christmas. Voracious Vegan just made a wonderful super chat donation, and she sent me 3 bottles of date syrup. I've been looking for your email to thank you so much, Voracious. We had a contest, Christina, for my 200th episode of Weight Loss Wednesday, and we gave away a Nutrimilk and a year's supply of date syrup, and Voracious Vegan, who's adorable, won it, and she sent me 3 bottles, and now she just made a super chat donation. Thank you so much, and Merry Christmas. Wow, see, your wonderful mushroom, your wonderful gravy brought me luck.
Oh, that's wonderful. Well, I was planning on actually going to Summerfest this year if they were to have it, but, you know, this past year, but unfortunately, you know, everything was with COVID was canceled, but, I hope to see everyone again. I miss all my friends from there. I've gone for over 10 years, and that's where I met you. And, you know, I've been in contact with you since then. I mean, you've been a really great mentor to me, so I appreciate it.
Well, let me help you. I mean, I can't write the book for you, but I mean, we can
help you
get it.
I have a lot of it together already, and I have ideas, and I actually want to incorporate some of growing food in it too as well, because so many people are, you know, using their food that they're growing. You know, we're not going to the stores as much. We're doing more home gardening. And so, yep.
Well, talk to us, because my husband and I sometimes teach a little business classes to get people's books out, and we've helped people. But if that's the only reason they're not having you, that's ridiculous. because you're a great chef. Well, thank you so much. The recipe looks delicious. Absolutely. And Merry Christmas. And we have two more chefs, so one more plus me. Thank you so much for doing it on time, too.
I can't wait to see your fruit cake.
Okay. Talk to you soon. Thank you, Chef Christina. Thanks, you guys, for hanging in. We've got two more chefs, but the next two, one of them's me, and I'll go really fast. And our next chef will go really fast, too. But she's an amazing chef. She's been on the show many times. She has a company called Vegan News Daily with her beautiful daughter, Kaylee, where they do cooking classes, and they're just beautiful. And I'm wearing a shirt she gave me today. Got a nice little, this would be great if I was breastfeeding, you know. Her name is Elspeth Feldman. She's also known as the Speedy Vegan. She has a wonderful Thanksgiving ebook, which you could use other times other than Thanksgiving. And because one of our chefs had a death in the family, she's doubling up and she's doing the entree and the salad. So that's spectacular. Please welcome Elspeth. Hello and Merry Christmas.
Hi, Chef AJ. Hi, everybody. Welcome to my kitchen and Merry Christmas to all of you.
Oh my God, you're a sexy Santa, let me tell you.
Well, thank you. I'm ready to get cooking here. And as you said, I'm making two dishes today. So one is going to be my chestnut and mushroom roast, which is going to look really festive and pretty. And the second one is a salad. It's a spinach and arugula salad with pears, pomegranates, and candied walnuts. And I could have put persimmons and pecans on there, but this is what we're doing today. So I'm going to get going quickly, speedy vegan style, because that's kind of my style of cooking. I've got a big pot here that I'm going to turn on. And this is just a, you know, big 8-quart pot, and I'm going to get some vegetables going. And then I'll move on to the salad, because actually salad is the main dish for a lot of us. So it's kind of appropriate that I'm doing a salad as an entree too. So first up, I have about 2 cups of onions here. I'm going to pop those into my big pot, all chopped up. And I use red onions just to keep Dr. Gregor happy. We've got all those anthocyanins in here. I've also got some carrots and some celery. So a lot of you will recognize the combination of onions, carrots, and celery as mirepoix, which is the base of a lot of soups and stews and a lot of recipes, just to get that sort of base flavor. And because we are racing along here today to get all this cooked, I'm going to go ahead and pop in my garlic. I forget how many cloves of garlic I said in the recipe, but I always kind of double it with the garlic, get some flavor in there. And I'm going to put in my mushrooms. So it doesn't matter what type of mushrooms you use. You can use cremini, you can use button mushrooms, shiitakes. It's just going to be a nice flavor. So this is going to cook for a little bit and get the water, the liquid to come out of the vegetables, and that should be fine. If the vegetables do start to stick, I always have a little bottle of water on the side so I can pour a splash of water in just so it doesn't stick. So I'm going to give that a stir. And then the next thing we need to get going on is the candied walnuts for the salad. So these vegetables are for the chestnut and mushroom wreath, no problem. And you probably, I don't know if you can hear squeaking, but we have a beautiful German Shepherd dog, Prince, and this is his first Christmas with us, and he finally discovered what Santa's all about. So he had a lot of squeaky toys under the tree. He's running around the house squeaking all of his toys. If you go to my Instagram stories, I'm the Speedy Vegan on Instagram, you can see some really cute pictures of Prince. And he's really happy about Christmas. So whilst the vegetables are sauteing, I'm going to get going on the candied walnuts. So let me just grab some of my ingredients for the salad here. So we've got many parts to the salad. We've got candied walnuts and we've got the dressing as well. So for the candied walnuts, I just need I don't typically candy my walnuts, but just because it's Christmas and it's fun, I thought I'd do that for you today, or for us. So I just spread them out on the baking sheet so that they have some room around them so that the heat can distribute well. And I'll pop those into the oven real quick.
Okay, really quick. Bailey wants to say Merry Christmas to everyone. She has a hat and she has a little thing, but she's not wearing it right now. So there she is. Follow me on Instagram. I try to make my Instagram more about Bailey than food because she got a little blanket for her holiday.
Isn't she cute? Don't you guys love pets? I love that y'all love pets and have pets and rescue pets. Elspeth's dog is wearing a Santa hat on Instagram today. How come you're not wearing your hat, huh? Anyway, the last episode of Beat Your Jeans, they talked about why we love our pets so much. So anyway, Bailey had to make an appearance.
Hey, Bailey. Yeah, life is so much better with a pet, especially with a rescue pet, I must say. But I was really glad that I didn't put all of the presents out by the Christmas tree last night. I put presents for my husband out there, but I didn't put Prince's tree as pets because he knew this morning that that bag was for him. And he sniffed it out and went and unpacked it right away. It was very cute. Just kind of really fun having a kid in the house for Christmas, I must say. So we have our vegetables sauteing down, and they'll take a little while because it's a whole lot of moisture that needs to come out of everything. So I'm going to move ahead and do the salad dressing part of the salad. So for the salad dressing, I have a little container here with orange juice. So this is fresh squeezed orange juice that I did this morning. And I usually make this up in a mason jar, but I'm going to add a couple of ingredients first. So this is the Dijon mustard. And if you're completely salt-free, you want to look for a salt-free version of mustard. This, a little bit of mustard. A little bit of date syrup, just to add a little bit of sweetness. I've got two things of date syrup out here. And I think in the recipe that I wrote, I did say to use apple cider vinegar, but I really love it with this California balsamic premium white balsamic vinegar. It's just so good. So you can use whatever vinegar you like, but I highly recommend this. The recipe that you have the link for does call for apple cider vinegar, but this is just so much better. So about 2 tablespoons of this. And this is approximately a cup of orange juice. So this is going to make a fair amount of dressing. Of course, the dressing is oil-free. Maybe I'll put a tiny splash of apple cider vinegar as well. And you can definitely measure this all out. I'm not one for measuring too much. So because I have the Dijon mustard in here and I don't want it to clump up, usually I pour everything into a mason jar and just shake it up. But I'm just going to use my little itty-bitty whisk here that I love and just whisk it in a little bit. So the mustard kind of emulsifies and gets going in this mixture. Give that a whisk. And a couple more ingredients that I need to add. I have some shallots. So for those of you who are not familiar with shallots, they are my preferred, you know, they're kind of like onion and garlic. So this is like a combination of. So I'll pop some shallots in here. And oh, a little dash of cinnamon as well. I also put cinnamon in this dressing. It's kind of festive and holiday-esque. And fresh oranges. So I just want to give a quick, and this is just a microplane. I'm just going to get some of this zest in here. Smells incredible. Just use the entire zest of the orange. And because I'm using the zest of an orange, I have made sure that this is an organic orange. So whenever you're using the zest of lemons, limes, or anything like that, just make sure you use an organic one because you don't want any of those horrible pesticides and things in here. And this smells incredible. So in there, and then I lost my whisk. I'm using this today, like pushing it in here because my daughter, who's watching from Boston with her husband, hey Kaylee, loves all my little teeny tiny kitchen tools. So I always make sure that I use it whenever she's not watching. And I also wanted to give a shout out to my son, Kyle, and his girlfriend, Anna Maria. They're watching from Pittsburgh. So missing our family, but really happy that everyone's safe and happy. So I'm gonna pour this into this jar. And I'm just gonna pour it back in there to make sure that I get all the rest of that. The date syrup needs to be clinging to the base of this. So I'll pour it in here and give this mason jar a shake. And that's it for the dressing. That's all ready for when we're ready to assemble a salad. I'm going to check back on my vegetables. Okay, give these a stir. So there's a whole lot of moisture that's cooking off here. The next ingredients that I'm going to add to this is some herbs de Provence. This is a wonderful herb mixture. It has rosemary and thyme and marjoram and sage. And we use this abundantly in our house. We absolutely love the flavors of the south of France. All of my family, my siblings all live in the south of France. So it's a place we visit often. So it takes us back. And I also have some tomato paste. So I'm going to pop in the tomato paste and give that a nice stir. And that's pretty much it for now. Once this is cooked down a little bit more, I'm going to just speed this up for you because I do already have one baked in the oven, just spoiler alert. But this is cooked up plenty here. Next ingredients we need to add are wild rice and brown rice. So you could make this, I'm gonna, but before I do that, actually, I'm gonna put in the vegetables. This is Swiss chard, rainbow chard. You could use spinach or whatever green leafy greens that you like, even arugula or something like that would work in here as well. But Swiss chard, especially the rainbow chard, is just so pretty and so plentiful at this time of year if you go to your farmer's market. I'm lucky enough to have a organic farmer close by, and I have a CSA share that I pick up my weekly batch from the farmer's market every weekend. And it's just really lovely to have nothing like having local produce. I highly recommend you look out for your local farmers. The produce is just so much fresher and so much better. And if you can find an organic farmer, that'd be even better. So this is just, you know, rough chopped, get your greens in. And this is, my pot is still on. So this is just gonna wilt down in the heat of the pot. And this is a chestnut and mushroom roast. So I do need to add the chestnuts. I have to say that this recipe I came up with specifically for this Christmas Day show. Chef AJ does not eat beans. So I couldn't put any beans in here. Charles, her husband, does not eat any quinoa. So I couldn't use quinoa. And she doesn't eat nuts either, but she does eat chestnuts, I believe. So
yeah, I do. I never saw them in a jar. I always see them in a bag.
Oh, wow. These are the La Forestier brand. And these are, you know, out of their shells and everything. So we're not going to be here cracking open chestnuts.
Where did you get the jarred ones?
I get these at Wegmans. Also seen them at Whole Foods.
Oh, nice.
So super easy. And they are just so low in fat. It's like a negligible amount of fat. So
I know, isn't that cool? Why can't all nuts be chestnuts?
I know, right? Huh? I know. Yeah. But it's just such a nice seasonal flavor as well. Chestnuts roasting on an open fire. We've got chestnuts going into a hot pot of vegetables here. So I'm going to turn off my heat and I'm going to pop the chestnuts into this mixture. And I'm also going to add the brown rice and the wild rice. Okay. So I cook those in advance in my Instant Pot. And I'm going to just give that all a big stir and show you what we do next.
You know, I wish we could all be together because then, you know, it would be so cool to like put the cauliflower mash in the middle of your thing and then put the, you know, Christina's mash and then Kathy's sauce around it. Wouldn't it be cool if somehow we were all together?
That would be fun. Maybe we can make that happen after the pandemic. We're all going to be like pent up, ready for a little bit of travel, a little bit of reconnection and seeing our family. We've really been staying home here. So I am quite happy to be home. I love being in my kitchen and creating all this lovely food, but it's going to be really fun to see everyone in person. So now I'm ready for, I'm going to keep an eye on our walnuts. I did make some in advance, so it doesn't really matter. We're not going to be burning anything here today. So just take a bundt pan. If you have a silicone bundt pan, that'd be great. But if you have, just make sure it's like a non-stick one. That's even better. And then just pop all of these vegetables into your bundt. And this is what's going to help form the wreath. And then I'm going to cover up the top of the bundt with a, you know, sheet of silver foil and pop this into the oven. So you get the idea. I'm not going to keep going here with this whole thing, but anyway, I would fill it all up and just bash it on the countertop for a little bit and then pop it into the oven. I'm going to put that lid on there so you don't have to worry about that. Pop this into the oven and cook it. Sorry.
Another super chat. Thank you, Angela Fischetti. Thank you so much. Boy, we're raking it in on Christmas, Bailey. I think it's because Bailey's so cute.
Yeah, and because you've been really, really nice this year, right, Chef AJ?
I've had no choice. I couldn't go anywhere and be mean. No, just kidding.
So I'm covering this with foil, popping into the oven. But I do have one that I've baked in advance, so I'm going to pull that out and show you what I do next with it. This is where the scary part happens, where we have to pop the Christmas wreath onto this. I like to use this cake stand. You can use any kind of platter that you want. I'm going to move this out the way. Let me grab my wreath. So for this one, I used my silicone bundt pan. So what you do here, and this is where we need a little bit of a drum roll. I'm going to place this upside down on top of my bundt pan. And I'm going to say this in advance. It really doesn't matter. If this whole bun thing like falls apart and crumbles and doesn't come together when I flip it over, it's not going to be in the world. I'm just going to get a spoon and I'm going to sort of fashion it together a little bit and make it look like a wreath. So doesn't matter. Okay, but here we go. One, two, three. Let's see. Sounded like it worked. And then I lift it off. Oh, ta-da, it worked. Okay, so we have our little wreath here. Got a hole in the middle. And what I do with it now is I get fancy and start decorating it. So I'm gonna move my big pot off the way. I do have a nice pot here of Brussels sprouts that I went ahead and steamed. So ideally you would coordinate this so your Brussels sprouts are nice and warm. And the Brussels sprouts are gonna look like these beautiful green baubles or Christmas ornaments that go around, you know, your Christmas table or your Christmas tree. So I'm gonna pop these all around here. I just steamed them and then blanched them very quickly so that they really are this bright, vibrant green. And then I have some, a whole bunch of radishes, some beautiful radishes, again, from my CSA, from my farmer. And I'm just gonna, some of them I've quartered, some of them are whole, and some of them are sliced, but I'm really just looking for these lovely bright colors that are, and you could go ahead and steam the radishes if you want. I like them crispy, like, you know, without being steamed or anything like that.
You know what's really good is putting radishes in the air fryer. They're amazing.
Oh, I bet that sounds incredible. I do not have an air fryer. So I, you know, I couldn't give you any advice on what to do with that. So now we're starting to look really pretty, but there's still a few more steps that I like to go. So I grab my rosemary. I know a lot of you probably have these at this time of year in your kitchen, but I'll just grab a few sprigs of rosemary from here and pop those around the top of the wreath. I also have some sprigs of thyme that I could use as well. So because we have the herbs de Provence inside the roast, it's nice to use some fresh herbs on the outside as well. And then if you want to have fun with it a little bit more, you could make a nice Christmas wreath out of zucchini or even red pepper would work as well. So I have a toothpick here and I've got a little end of the radish. That's gonna be the center of my bow. And I just take some nice slices of the, using a vegetable peeler, just get some nice strips of green. Hope you can see this from the zucchini. And these are, I'm just gonna fashion this into a bow real quickly. And so you can use the white side or the light green side or the dark green side. And I just kind of get a bunch of these little strips of zucchini and I bunch them together. And then I make sure that I have a few little tassels hanging down for the ribbon. You can go have a, you know, just make a fun little bow like that. And then I grab my toothpick with the radish inside and I pop it through the center of the bow. And you can stick it into the actual wreath itself, or you could stick it onto the vegetables. But I'm going to ask my husband to try and tilt the camera a little bit here so you can see how pretty this whole wreath thing looks. You can see that. So it's really a wonderful meal. You've got your everything all in one. You have your vegetables, you have your main course. And as I say, I made this without beans. I know a couple of your viewers wrote to me in advance and asked for some other alternatives to chestnuts because they couldn't find chestnuts. You could use walnuts, you could use pecans, and you could use lentils. There is a step in this where I take one cup of the mixture and I put it in a blender and I make it into a paste. And then I put it inside the mixture before I put it in the bunch. And that kind of binds it together really well. So that's it for the wreath, the Christmas wreath. I'm going to move on to the rest of the salad, if that's okay, Chef AJ.
Absolutely. The people are saying your presentation skills are outstanding. Everything looks beautiful and delicious. Where did you get that sense of style, both in clothing and in food? I wish I could channel you, man.
I don't know. I'm a little farm girl from Zimbabwe, and I don't know. We didn't have any of this growing up, but my mother always presented our food really beautifully, so maybe I got it from mom. Okay, so for the salad, I have a whole bunch of arugula, I have a whole bunch of spinach, and I'm just going to toss them together here, so we have the greens mixed in together. I love arugula and spinach mixed, so that's it, and I'm going to take some of the dressing, so just shake it up a little bit. I'm probably going to put about quarter to half a cup of dressing. I like my salad dressed very lightly. Is that the right word? I guess. But I will put this in a nice container and put that on the table as well so that people can add more dressing to their salad. But for this initial round, I just want to coat all the greens in this lovely dressing. And it's nice. It's easier to do it if you do it in a bowl ahead of time. So it's my greens. Nearly had an accident there. And then I take my two salad plates.
And I'm going. Did you get your plates at Williams Sonoma?
I didn't actually. You know, I think I bought these at a grocery store many years ago. But Williams Sonoma does have these.
Because I have, that's this, Dr. Steve Lewenda got me a housewarming present. And I have, that's what I have is square white plates. I like square plates better than round plates.
Yeah, they add a nice, they're a lot of fun. Yeah. And you know what I added to my life this year as well is I got some black plates from Williams Sonoma. And that really makes the food pop very pretty. It's very, very pretty. So, okay. So I'll have a little bit of dressing on the side. I've got a pear here ready to be sliced up. So I'm just gonna slice up the pear. So I just cut alongside the core, you know, just make sure you don't get too much of the seeds inside. And then I just pinch up on my knife for the little, you know, grip right on the blade and use my bear claw grip and slice a few slices of a perfect pear. And I'll arrange the slices on top, you know,
I was going to say it's 3 hours later there. You technically could eat this meal now.
This timing is absolutely perfect. We are planning to eat this meal hot. I have some gravy made, which is from my Pod My Turkey cookbook, my Thanksgiving cookbook. And I also have some cranberry, raw cranberry sauce from my Pod My Turkey as well. So that's perfect. So we're already set to eat lunch. And then pomegranates. And if you want to see how I de-seed a pomegranate, if you go to our YouTube channel, which is Vegan News Daily YouTube channel, definitely check that out. You can see how quick and easy it is to de-seed a pomegranate. So that's that. And then I need to grab my candied walnuts. So these are ones that I've made in advance. Our candied walnuts that we put in. I don't have the top oven turned on, so they're not actually working. These are already crisp and candied. So I'll just take a couple of these and pop them over the top.
As they cool, you're killing me with candied nuts. Oh my God. It's killing me.
You know, it's Christmas, so I think I'm going to eat these today too. But they just really crisp up nicely. And it's just got, honestly, it's got like a hint of date syrup on it and the cinnamon. So here we have it. Beautiful salads. Ready for Christmas. And as I say, I could also, you know, grab one of the persimmons and make it a pear and pomegranate persimmon and pecan salad. But this is what we went with today. So that's it. If you want to follow us and see if there are any more recipes, you can get the recipes at the link that Chef AJ has in the show notes. And head over to vegannewsdaily.com/store. And you can see all of our wonderful, fabulous classes. We have a 40% off sale going today. So if you still need a Christmas present for somebody, that's the best price that we've ever offered our classes. And you know, find out more there. And I also wanted to tell you quickly, I'm going to be following in your footsteps, Chef AJ. I'm going to be doing a Chibo class and I have a Valentine's menu coming up that is absolutely fabulous. Portobello steaks.
Do you know what day you're doing it? Do you know what day it is yet?
I don't know. I think it's probably going to be about February 10th. I'm going to do it a couple of days in advance of Valentine's so that people can get their chops down and know how to cook this fabulous meal. And it's going to include chocolate souffle for dessert.
Oh my God, it's going to be amazing. Guys, check out Chibo. It's just a great platform because you can cook with us in real time. My Valentine's Day class is February 6th. So we'll get you that information. I'm so glad you're doing it.
Yeah, it's going to be fun. It's going to be a different style for me because as with Chibo, you slow down and you cook along and you do things really slowly. I'm very much the speedy vegan style has always been my style, but this is going to be fun for people who want to see it a little bit slower paced. But yeah, so this looks festive. This looks fun. Thank you so much, Chef AJ, for having me on. And how can I help you transition to your kitchen now? Do you need
You know what, Elspeth? I have to, you keep, just talk to people for a minute. So guys, talk until you see me in the kitchen. Thanks.
Okay, I'll tell you. Okay, if I knew how to sing, I would definitely sing you a song, but if my daughter were here,
Carole, are you ready?
Yeah. So Chef AJ is going to be doing her It's Not Your Grandma's Fruitcake, which I am super excited about. My mother used to make the most fabulous fruitcake, non-vegan fruitcake. I lost my mother this year, so I'm looking forward to learning how to make Chef AJ's Not Your Grandma's Fruitcake. And I'm super excited about these salads. So yeah, so if any of you want to join us for our Chibo class, it's going to be in February, probably around February 10th. I'm going to be making I think it's going to be a spinach and strawberry salad. Then we're going to have portobello steaks, onion rings, baked fries, grilled asparagus, and chocolate souffle for dessert. So it's going to be quite a menu. I'm very excited about that. And as I say, go ahead and have a fabulous vegan Christmas. Sending lots of love to all of you who are safe at home, those of you who are on your own, or those of you who are loved ones too. So
okay, yay! Thank you. Thank you so much, Elspeth. Can you guys see me? Because I'm not at the computer anymore.
Yeah, we can see you, Chef AJ.
Oh, perfect. Okay, thank you.
Merry Christmas.
I've never actually done it this way before. So Merry Christmas, everyone. And I'm going to show you how to make Not Your Grandma's Fruitcake. So we're going to start with some orange juice right here in the pan. You'll get the recipe in the show notes. But first thing I'm going to do is I'm just going to turn this on. I've got the orange juice already measured out. It's 3 cups. This pan was given to me by Chef Bravo. He came to my house to cook and he was not impressed with my pans and he replaced all of them. So now one thing I want to say about the orange juice is I've been working on this for 2 years and I made this 2 years ago at True North using what they had. And then I forgot the recipe. So I had to like recreate it because I didn't write anything down. And I tried all different fruits. And it's not that you can't substitute, you can, but if you want it to taste like mine, then, you know, I've tried apricots. I've tried different kinds of fruits. And this is my favorite combination. Just be mindful that orange juice doesn't always taste good. And I mean that I've bought an organic orange juice fresh and it's tasted really, really bitter. So make sure that before you are using this, because we're going to macerate the fruit, we're going to reduce it. It has to taste good because if it's bitter orange juice, sometimes it just is.
it's your fruitcake is not going to taste good. So make sure that you like the actual juice you're using, whether it's from concentrate or fresh. And if it doesn't taste good, then use another juice. Apple juice is very, very sweet. If you like things super duper sweet, apple juice is sweeter than orange juice, and pineapple juice is sweeter than apple juice, but I'm using orange juice. I did get them in a box. If I was using fresh, then I would also include the zest. So what I'm going to do is add to this, and you can just back up a little bit, Charles. One of the things I teach in my Chibo classes and all my classes is something called mise en place, everything in its place. When you do that with any recipe, it goes much faster to have everything out and measured, so you're not running from cabinet to cabinet and measuring out. So I've got my four fruits. And everything actually was available at Trader Joe's. I'm very lucky. I know some of you don't have a Trader Joe's, but you should be able to find unsulfured, unsweetened fruit somewhere, whether it's Trader Joe's, Sprouts, Whole Foods. We get it at the local Winco, definitely on Amazon. And so the fruits I'm using are yellow raisins because I prefer them. I both prefer the color and I think they're sweeter. So I'm putting in the raisins. And then I am putting in the dates. The reason I like to use deglet nor dates in my fruitcake is, Craig, is that I love medjools. They're sweeter, but they're harder to cut. And we don't want whole dates. We want them cut. And the deglet nor seem to hold up a little better. They're also cheaper. So then they're going in. You can get them organic, very cheap at Costco. Big, big tubs for like $7.99. And then I have one of my favorite dried fruits, which is cherries. You can get the unsweetened, unsulfured at Trader Joe's. And I did cut my fruit because I don't want big pieces for me in my fruit cake. If you like big pieces, you don't have to cut it up. I have a little pair of scissors I got from Tupperware that are like, you know, food scissors, which you can use regular scissors if you're not using them. And then the dried pineapple, which I also cut. And pineapple and cherry together, I want to say it's almost tropical a little bit with the orange juice. You can get this at Costco, but you can also get it online. And like I said, you can get dried pineapple and dried cherries at Trader Joe's. Now, I'm going to add my spices. And there's five. I almost called this 5+5 fruit cake because there's five fruits and five spices. If you've ever watched any of my stuff, you know that I always measure everything out in advance that I'm going to do because it's just easier to do that. And so now what I have to do is I have to cook it down. So what I'm doing is I'm reducing it till all the liquid is gone. So I'm stirring it in. And while I'm doing that, I'll tell you a few things to do. Now, here's the thing. My parents used to always say, do as I say, not as I do. You really have to cool this. You really, really do. You got to believe me on that. You can't just go from hot and then bake it. But I don't want you guys to have to sit here for another couple hours. So I'm going to do something that you're not allowed to do. I'm going to mix it all together. And I'm not going to bake it. You have to wait till it cools. But I just want to show you that part, how I'm going to decorate the thing once it cooks down. And basically, this is just really a fruit cake because it's mostly fruit. Yes, it's dried fruit. It's calorically dense. But that's pretty much what's in it. Just there's going to be 2 cups of grain, which isn't much. So while that's cooking down, I'm going to show you the finished one. So here's the one I've already made. You can see how beautiful this is. I would say this is about 12 slices. It's fairly rich. It's very satisfying. It's very dense. It freezes great, by the way, because I made this one. I don't even remember when it's been in the freezer. And what's really nice is if there are leftovers, you can slice it and either toast it or cook it in your air fryer. Now I've tried this in the bundt pan like Elspeth used, but I liked it better in the traditional loaf pan. This is like $7. I can find a link for you. Just these loaf pans are great when you're doing SOS for your oil-free, nothing sticks to them. These are also great for loaves, type loaves. But if you didn't want to do that, you could do miniature ones in, they make little small silicone ones. And I did have some metal ones here I was going to show you. This is for the Instant Pot air fryer combo, these little ones. You could make mini fruit cakes. My mother used to make a chocolate fruit cake every year. It was absolutely delicious. And that would be the gift she would give out to everybody. So the way I would decorate this one is, first of all, I have a pretty plate right here, if you want to just show the pretty plate. And then what I like to do is, especially because cranberries are only 10 cents a bag where I live, it's amazing. I would just throw them around, not throw them, but put them around the whole cake. And I think that would be really, really pretty to do that.
some on the other side. And then since we're not going to eat the raw cranberries, I will just make a recipe with them. If you have my new book, Own Your Health, there's a cranberry spritzer that's great. So I would do that. And Own Your Health, by the way, is on Audible now. And if you buy it before December 31st, you get a lot of bonuses if you email your receipt to Own Your Health book. So you can see how beautiful this is. Now, let me show you how we do the top. Because if you don't do the top pretty, let me just give this another stir. I'm cooking this really, really quickly on high in the interest of time. And by the way, if you are commenting right now, I can't see anything because I'm cooking. So I'm just cooking this down, down, down. And it takes a few minutes. You don't have to do it on quite as high heat as me, but you're not cooking when people are filming you. So the reason I like to decorate the top is because otherwise it's just kind of brown and not that pretty. So what I do is I buy the unsweetened, unsulfured pineapple rinds. I got these at Trader Joe's, but I'm sure there's other places to get them. And then I'm going to line my pan with them. And then I'm going to put a whole cherry in between because I think that's really pretty. So you're just going to put down as many as will fit. And then this will bake up real pretty. There we go. And if one breaks, that's okay. You can always put it together. So actually, I will take a few pieces, maybe half rings to fill in the spot, or you can overlap too, doesn't matter. That one, I'll just use the half ring there. Maybe like that. Oh, that's really boiling fast. It just makes it look kind of pretty. And then I'm going to take my cherries after I give this a stir. I didn't put vanilla powder in, but you certainly could put a teaspoon in. The spices are cinnamon, nutmeg, cloves, ginger, and cardamom. And the ginger I used was the gingerbread spice from local spicery because it's one of my favorite. And then I'm going to take my cherries just to put it in a little hole. Just because it looks kind of pretty. Cherry and pineapple together are just the best. And so I'm not going to cut these. I'm going to leave these whole and put them in the pineapple hole just to make it look a little pretty. And then if there's a space there, I can put another cherry. And that's just makes it look a little prettier on top when you turn it upside down. Okay, so this is almost reduced, and then when it's fully reduced so that there's really no liquid left, I'm going to put in my grain. And so I am using oats and millet. Now, if you can't get millet, just substitute another half cup of oats. The reason I'm using millet is because I have found when you do baking with, I don't like to grind anything into a flour. I say that, and then I said I ground this in a flour. But I prefer to use the grain as whole as possible. So I try to use whole oats for everything. And I have 1.5 cups here. So there's 2 cups total, which is not much in the whole thing. I have found that when I use oats without any millet, it's like a gummy texture, which as a former restaurant pastry chef, I don't like. And I have found that by just taking 1/2 cup of my millet and grinding it, and I like grinding it myself rather than buying millet flour. And I'll tell you why for a couple of reasons. One, it's a lot cheaper. And two, then I don't have to grind it finely. Let me just show you the millet I get. Because some of you are saying you can't find millet at the store. I actually find millet at both Whole Foods and Sprouts, but I find it's just cheaper if I buy it on Amazon, and I'd rather buy it whole because then I can use it as a whole grain, which is really delicious. And so this is almost cooked down enough that I'm going to stir in both my oats and my millet. But again, please don't try this at home. Let it cool and you'll have a much better result. Because let me tell you, I really shouldn't do this because what's going to happen is when by adding it hot, I'm cooking my grain, and we don't want to do that because we're using it to bake. But I don't know any other way to do this unless I would have got a third pan, and then we'd be eating fruitcake forever. So it's just going to take another minute to reduce. And if you like these multi-chef shows, let me know what holidays you'd like to see, and I could probably assemble the team again. There's actually, let's see, there were 7 of us today and 3 didn't make it from last time. So that's 10. So we got a nice little team. And, you know, I just want to show you guys that it doesn't have to be difficult to make healthy food, and that if you are SOS free, it's delicious. And even if you're not SOS free, I promise you all the recipes that we made are eaten by regular people. At least I've always tested mine on regular people. Ooh, that's hot. So almost there, reducing down. Yeah, I actually made this once with orange juice I didn't taste. It was terrible. So make sure, you know, if you don't like your ingredients before they go in, nothing magical happens in the cooking. So Elspeth was telling you guys about Chivo. I'll put a link in. I'm doing an amazing class for Valentine's Day. It's called Sweets for Your Sweethearts. It's all chocolate desserts. They're SOS free, but they are not weight loss desserts. So if you're looking for ultimate weight loss, take the January Chivo class with all my new weight loss friendly recipes, including my caramel blondies that'll be good for that. Wow, this is really, really hot. Really, really hot. So basically we're making stewed fruit. This fruit right here, if you didn't want to make the fruit cake, you could still make the stewed fruit. And this could be something you put on a morning oatmeal. You could put this on banana ice cream. You'd wait for it to cool a little bit, of course. So that would be kind of a cool thing. I could show you what I'm making, what I've made for dinner, but it really doesn't look like anything because it's a layered dish. But what I've done is this is going to get baked for my dinner, and we've got mashed potatoes on top, and then there's a bottom layer of stuffing. And the stuffing that I made is made from parsnips, carrots, onion, and mushrooms and stuffing spices. So it looks like stuffing and it tastes like stuffing, but it has no bread or gluten or grain. So I'm gonna bake this up and then we're gonna put the cranberry sauce on top. So I got this idea from Jen Shipley, who was on the show right before Thanksgiving. He did the celebration loaves. Almost cooking down. We're only a little bit over time for this show. One of the chefs went over. So, sorry. If I was still working in the restaurant, we'd have a deep freeze. I could walk in and be ready in a couple of minutes. All right, there we go. I'm gonna call it good. I'm gonna turn my thing off. And then I'm gonna stir in my grain. Again, please don't do this at home because basically I'm cooking the oatmeal, not a good idea. For fruit cake, but I want to show you how easy it is. And then my millet again. If you don't want to use the millet, use all oats. It may have a little bit gummy texture, but it is what it is. So let's move this over here. And I am not going to cook it until this cools down, but I am stirring it in for you. And I've got my little rings in place, my decorative top. And I'm wearing a decorative top that was a gift from Elspeth, by the way. I hope you guys have a happy holidays, whether you're with someone or alone. This too shall pass. We'll get through this. And eating healthy is one of the best things you can do to get through a pandemic because you want to avoid it in the first place. And if your immune system is strong, you're going to be fine. And that's how we, there we go. Whoa, that is a hot, that's the only thing with the pans Ramses gave me. They got hot handles. So because I'm right-handed, I'll have to go like this, and then I'm going to put it on top, and then I'm going to bake it for about 50 to 55 minutes. I like to always cool things in the oven. Just turn the oven off, let it cool. Don't take it out before it's ready. That's one of the secrets to vegan baking, I think, and not over mixing as well. I studied under a pastry chef, Eric Lachasseur. You can find one of his videos on this channel. And don't forget, if you need some inspiration, we have a bonus show today, 2 p.m. I'll be talking with Richard Hubbard, whose book just came out. He's lost over 150 pounds. And again, I mean, I suppose you could grind the oats if you really didn't, you know, if you really didn't like the way this looked for some reason, to see the whole oats in the side. You could do it all flour, but you know, flour's not my jam. So there you have it, not your grandma's fruitcake. And now I have got to run back to the other room and say goodbye and end the show. All right, I'm back. Okie dokie, put my headphones on. Oh, that's hard. It's hard being in two places at once. There we go. Okay, so there you have it.
So I couldn't have seen the comments in the last few minutes, but I'll try to check them afterwards. Thank you so much for watching my channel, being subscribed to my channel or my newsletter, or just being in my community, whether this is the first time you've been here or the millionth. I don't think there's been a million, maybe how many have I done? 355 shows, I think. So happy, healthy holiday to all of you. Prosperous new year, and come back at 2 o'clock and we'll have another inspiring story. And tomorrow we're having another amazing cooking demo with another great SOS free chef, Vicky Gatch Brett. She's going to do burgers a whole bunch of ways. Merry Christmas, everyone. Thanks so much for being here.